Welcome to Spiritual Spectrum, the show that deals with topics on the American religious scene. Today's topic is No Other Name. This book, written by Paul F. Nitter back in 1981, is a book that covers a number of interesting topics regarding the relationship of the world religions to Christianity. I won't say any more about that before I introduce our guests and let them talk about it a little bit more. Let me start on my extreme left with Mr. Bill Sheeley, Reverend Bill Sheeley, of the American Baptist Church. To his left, we have Julio Edwards, who is producer of Spiritual Spectrum. And
hi, Mom.
To his left, Jill Ho, an educational psychologist and...
Psychologist and educator,
okay. And to her left, Mr. Lawrence Wollersheim. Lawrence, I know a little bit about what you do, but maybe you could explain just a little bit about the organization you work for, FACT, I believe.
FACT. I'm a director in an organization that works with abuse victims. Mm-hmm. Sometimes religious abuse, but all forms of cultic abuse or abuse of psychological coercion, you know, that type of thing. So,
okay. And I'm Andre Radatus, your host. Let's start off with a very simple question. What is the meaning of No Other Name? What does that mean? Why did the author choose to name his book No Other Name?
I can just say I had this book with me when I went to the chiropractor a couple days ago, and he was lying on the floor as I was getting ready to be adjusted. And he just looked at the name and he said, religious pluralism, huh? So I think he chose the name because it really does tell people what the book's going to be about. I was surprised that anybody just reading that would really know what it was about, but he did.
That's interesting. So would you say that this book has a particular audience in mind? Because I, when I first picked up the book, that didn't convey anything particularly to me other than what I'd heard about the book. Is there a particular group of readers that Paul F. Nitter has in mind when he writes this book?
I think there's several levels of potential readers. The one that he's targeting on the first level might be the Christian community, to open them up to read and study and dialogue and meet people of other religions and find out about them, to appreciate their own Christianity. And then I think there's another level where he hopes people from other religions will also do the same and find out more about Christianity. And I think he does have an underlying tone of hoping they'll convert to Christianity. But I think that the very idea of just plain dialoguing is good enough for most people. It's a good enough start to just get everyone talking.
I see. So he's presenting that starting a religious dialogue is the first step in wherever it will lead. It will at least lead to the religions talking to each other.
And I think by using this name for his book, No Other Name, he's gently suggesting to Christians who insist in their first sentence to other religionists that the only way to approach God is through the name of Jesus, that they're eliminating dialogue before it begins. That's why the question mark.
Oh, I see.
I feel that actually he also wants to go after the group of people who are very troubled in their own mind, who do in fact have some very great concerns about what they've been taught from time to time or within their own tradition, that there is no other name. And sometimes that is stated so strongly that some of our Christian people, with their own sympathies being broader than that, find that they're really very disturbed by that, and they find a conflict between their own very warm-hearted and open kinds of views and as against the views of, well, say for example, the particular minister they may be listening to at a particular time.
I think there's another group. unacknowledged pluralists, people who feel that salvation may be possible outside their faith, people who feel that God is present in other faiths and reveals himself in unique ways, and they may not have formally seen these kind of views expressed from a religious, theological, or theoretical point, or from the various other models that Nitter uses in his book to express that this latent kind of sense of religious community or religious pluralism has good, sound, logical, and theological bases besides this sense of community we would feel in tolerance towards each other. So that there actually is an unacknowledged group of pluralists out there that when they read this book, it goes, oh yeah, I've been feeling this for a long time and there's good reason for it too. And I think even some of the pluralists that have acknowledged their sense of religious pluralism and tolerance and appreciation would be a target audience for this book as well, because people like to reconfirm what they already know and have somebody tell them they're right.
Mm. Mm-hmm. But who is that person? What is a religious pluralist? What is, you like to take that hook?
Well, I'm sure there's lots, every single one on the planet will have a different opinion about it. For me, it means that I can accept the best of all religions, not just on paper or in a book, but I can go attend their worship service or their study group or their prayer service and actually participate and try to find a better relationship with God through all the different religions and through their traditions and rituals. And have an open enough mind that if actually something strikes my heart in a religion that I didn't think much of before or believe in or have any knowledge about, to actually accept that grain of salt or whatever for what it's really worth.
I'm curious about what you said earlier, Bill, you know, the idea of Christians that have had a broader sympathy and may need, as is being suggested here, you know, some confirmation that that's okay.
Right. I think that's true, that we do need we need various kinds of authorities or someone else who we think at least knows a little more than we do or can document things in a little bit different, better way than we could, mm-hmm. to be able to say, yes, this is the way things are, or it is not simply this narrow view of life, but there is another alternative way.
So Nitter, when he speaks of pluralism, he is speaking of it in this positive sense. And do you feel he is trying to expand in the mind of the average Christian the possibility?
Well, I think that what Nitter says is that actually, and I believe, and this is not word for word, but I believe that he said that the world, and we know in other ways it already is, that the world is pluralistic. In other words, historically, for a long time, no religion has had to really take into account the other religions around them. But Nitter says that, hey, here we are, we're going to be having people of all sorts marrying into our families. They're going to be people that we work with. They're going to be people that we have our coffee break with. It is already a pluralistic world. And religiously, it is pluralistic. And so we have to, someone or other, come to terms with that and get off the notion that really we still have this nice, what some people would say, this nice Protestant kind of religion here in the United States. We don't have it.
Yeah, correct me if I'm wrong, anyone, but is he suggesting in part of the book that to maintain an attitude that you know, there is no other name other than, say, Jesus for Christians or for any other religion, that their religion is the only way, that because they live in a pluralistic society, it's almost a schizophrenic kind of life they have to live, one where they live with other people, but they live with this concept in the back or the front of their mind that they're not one of what I am, a Christian or whatever particular group. They're on the outside and I'm on the inside. Does he suggest that at all to anybody?
I didn't pick that up.
One of the things that's similar to that is he's saying that in some philosophies or some models, people believe that it's absolutely required that they convert people to their way of belief, because they believe otherwise they won't be saved. Yeah. And so that responsibility becomes an urgent life responsibility based on that belief. Mm-hmm. And he's, by the time he gets to the end of the book, the belief system that he's promoting relieves that responsibility.
Hmm. A high appreciation for how God is manifest in another religion, in another culture, or another circumstance, and that through this appreciation of the unity of God's reaching out and sharing himself and his love and revealing himself, that we enhance our religious dimension. We develop this better relationship with God that Julio was talking about, and through that we're actually going for something that brings us together at a better enhanced level than something that separates us. Mm-hmm. He's suggesting this model that there's more to religious pluralism than just tolerance and dialogue. There's enormous benefit in the sense of experiencing God in the unique ways that you've experienced God, and how that could enhance my relationship with God. And that's really sort of the subtle fabric design that goes through the book, is everything additional that you can add to your own faith without throwing the foundational pylons of your faith away. Mm. It's a very unique psychological state where Nitter says that it's completely legitimate to hold on to, if you feel that Christ is the normative highest manifestation in your faith. Continue to do that. Mm-hmm. You know, don't take that away from yourself in your exploration of finding God and his relationship to other religions and other people who love him. And while maintaining that mind state, be open to the possibilities of how God might reveal himself to you in new ways. And it's kind of, it pushes the edges of logic, but religion itself and faith pushes the edges of logic, and love pushes the edges of logic. Mm-hmm. So the model, I think, that he's suggesting is one of love and of faith in God and his nature, that he would reach to everyone and find ways to draw all to him, and not to to stand on your foundation of your culture, religious culture, but don't make that foundation of pylons a set of bars that would deny you more God in your life as you find it in different places.
Well, he elaborates on that a little bit. He hits into something he calls the theocentric model. And I'm wondering if somebody would elaborate on what that theocentric model is. He almost uses that as the hub of how this will occur. And it seems to me that a lot of people in our audience, certainly in my mind, I wonder how is it going to happen that people will come to adopt an attitude of religious pluralism, where they look at everybody else's religion as okay. Clearly, we don't have that in a place like Northern Ireland, for a clear example. And how is that going to come about? And one thing suggests is a theocentric model. Let's get some clarity on that, first of all.
Well, I think we want Lawrence to address that maybe, but before you get to that, that's a really good example. If you take Ireland, and regardless of how you look at their Christocentric Christianity, it doesn't make much difference, the fact that they both groups believe in the same Bible and believe in the same Christ, the same Trinity. There's still a huge difference between what they get out of the same belief system.
Mm-hmm.
So even though this theocentric model gives us a lot of hope for some dialogue and some basic agreement on a lot of tenets, it probably won't make much more difference than people who already are of the same belief in the same book and still kill each other and fight. It has to do with the individuals and what they do with it.
Mm-hmm.
But the model's extremely important.
Well, how do we get, I guess the question becomes, how do we get it to work? First of all, let's understand what it is.
Imagine the word Christocentric gives us a little key to the model, and your comment on a hub. Imagine Christ being the hub of the Christocentric religious model of all the religious faiths that have Christ as the central hub to the Father, to God, the ultimate or the oneness. Buddhist would have a Buddha-centric model. Another religion that has a specific leader that they consider to be the highest manifestation and highest quality of deity revelation, that religion could say to have a
like the Baha'is,
a Baha'u'llah-centric model, or a, and these are models, and if you imagine them on one plane as, or even if you imagine them at different planes, as wheels, but yet all of those wheels are focusing up towards a manifestation of deity that is one, universal, has personal and impersonal qualities, and it's this universal God the Father, the original source. You know, we all believe in God, and that God that we instinctively say we believe in is probably that oneness concept that we all share, although we may get to that senior or universal concept through a specific model of our faith, a theocentric model, a Buddha-centric model, a Baha'u'llah-centric model. And what Nitter's suggesting is that if we put more emphasis on our appreciation of our oneness in our theocentric, this God model, and an appreciation of how we're all ultimately focusing to this endpoint and not the process points. The process points that divide us in different perspectives and cultures, and that we hold to the senior endpoint, that we will find that our process points are rich, are beautiful, they contribute to each other and enhance this process of a greater understanding of the end theocentric model. And so that what looks like conflict when we're strictly in our hub, moving out and appreciating and experiencing other people's religions and their hubs, helps enhance the endpoint as opposed to the process. And makes it better in the process and richer in the endpoint. So we become richer on two levels by acknowledging the commonness of our theocentric model, although we may get there through a different process model.
I think a prime example of that might be Walter Bundy's opinion of the religion of Jesus. Jesus was one of the few people to use the word Abba. If you look up a lot of Hebrew scriptures, you won't find the word in there very often. And he had a theocentric religion. The religion about him that came about became more Christocentric. And they kind of tried to get back to it, in my opinion, through the Trinity concept. But the reason I think Jesus could see so much good in all other people was he put aside the religious differences, and his theocentricness allowed him to love Samaritans because he knew they were still worshiping the same God, although his traditional religion would not have recognized the God of the Samaritans.
Mm-hmm. And another thing that Nitter points out was Jesus' function on the planet, according to most Christians even, was to reveal God, mm-hmm. not to reveal himself. I mean, he was always pointing to God. So if everybody is pointing to God, then people are all pointing in the same direction, and it's a lot easier to recognize that commonality. Mm-hmm.
I don't think any Christian who looks, say, at the Gospels would dispute that aspect. But there is, of course, all the other Christology of all of Christ's followers and all of what you'll find, for instance, in the epistles and those commentators, you know, discussing. So you have people. We're not dealing simply with philosophy here. If it was, and it was a matter of just changing constructs, that might be easy. We're talking about people's core beliefs. And so, as much as I understand what is being said about a theocentric model, and how if people look at the highest in their religion and realize that that is the same in everybody else's model, and that that's perhaps...
It might not be the same, and I think this is an important distinction. Mm. Saying the same and equal isn't precise enough.
Clarify that.
What I mean by that is that each faith in its tradition may have different levels of revelation and deity fact and spiritual heritage, which is reflective of the true nature of God, or the universal nature of God. And there may be differences in the different evolutions of religion and different cultures that these religions come from, and they also may be reflecting different qualities of God. And by making them all the same and making them all equal, we lose too much. There's much to be gained by these differences, which enhance the quality of our own religious experience.
Let's clarify what you mean by differences, though. Do you mean by differences in the core, the fundamental aspect of one's experience, one's religious experience, or do you mean more of differences of how we intellectually perceive a religious experience?
I would say there's differences in there's obviously going to be differences in individual experiences because we're all individually different. But I was speaking more about the culture of the religion, the spiritual wisdom, the tenets, the way the religion describes the nature of God. There are fundamental differences between Buddhists and traditional Christians and different types of Christians. And we shouldn't paste those all under the table.
Right.
We should honor those differences because there's a great wealth to be learned from the variety of experience. And by saying they're all equal is saying that maybe some religions haven't evolved more than others. And I don't think that's practical reality in the world. I think that some religions may have evolved a closer reflection of God's nature and God's reality than others. There are primitive religions, you know, that may not have very much intellectual understanding of God. There are religions that may only see God from one light, like an impersonal light.
Well, let me break in there for a second. As soon as you see, here, let's just say we're a group of religious pluralists, and you now have just referred to a religion that is primitive, clearly a pejorative term. If you had one of those individuals from that particular religion sitting here in that group. And so when we all have our understanding and we all have our experiences. I guess what I was trying to get at is, how do we unify that? How do you allow religious pluralism to have at least the unity of that common understanding that somehow we're not that different? To me, that has to be a core belief here, isn't it?
Unity isn't sameness or oneness in the pluralistic sense. Unity is complementarity, where we gain a unity by combining differences and growing from the differences. I didn't mean so much primitive as
in a pejorative sense.
Right. I didn't mean it in that sense, but there are differences, and I've learned from other people's faiths and how they've lived their faith in ways that I had never experienced before about who God was, what his nature was, and how he reveals himself in life. And there are differences, and these are not to be, in a true pluralistic model, kind of meshed together, all is the same, all is equal.
Right, and in a sense, recognizing that, I think, helps those persons who find the idea of pluralism or of this sort of homogenized picture, but being able to recognize that, I think, is a help for people that say, well, all you're wanting to do is to water down all the religions. And I think it is important that we recognize that there are differences. I think where Christianity has the difficulty is that we as Christians don't want to even consider the thought that maybe there is something in another religion that can teach us something about God that we don't already know.
Or isn't in our faith.
Yeah, or isn't in our faith. And I think that's where a lot of the fear comes for those of us who sincerely want to do God's will, but have been so immersed, good Baptist term, so immersed within our own tradition. And so it is a difficult process that we're thinking of to be pluralistic.
We're talking about religion as a vehicle and not a cage. If we see it as something that takes us into other areas that we can learn and add to and put new things in our vehicle and we discover new things, that's this model. And the paradox of it is that it allows you the faith and your personal experience of what you know to be true and to be the highest revelation of God that you've experienced in your life, and at the same time allows you to look elsewhere, as opposed to my experience must be the sum total of experience, or my religion must have the sum total of knowledge and experience of all deity knowledge, all God knowledge, as a box. You know, because intellectually, none of us would say my experience equals all experience, my knowledge equals all knowledge. We'd have to laugh at ourselves. Religiously, can we make that statement?
One of the things that makes sense to me is I believe God loves all people equally, and God wants all people to come to Him. And it's my belief that sincerity is the key. So people who sincerely are seeking for God have, by that fact, proven that God has found them. And that connection's made, that avenue is complete. And so it's easy for me, getting more easy all the time, for me to honor other people's ways of expressing their sincerity and to admire them for their degree of sincerity and to retain my own belief system and to work on my degree of sincerity and dedication. I have, for instance, read a number of books by Jewish authors like Chaim Potok. Hasidic Jews I very much admire for their dedication. I'm not at all inclined to become Jewish, and I very much admire the amount of the degree to which they dedicate their entire lives to their spiritual path, and they live their beliefs so wholeheartedly. I greatly admire that. So if nothing else, if I don't learn anything different about God, I learn at least how to serve God or how to live one's beliefs by watching other people's expression of sincerity.
Well, you know, Joe, what you mentioned was you said that in certain circumstances, you know, that God has touched certain people. And I think that brings in to the discussion another dimension that I think is very much on the religious scene these days, and that is the fact that we have more than just our religion that influences us. We also have, by whatever name we call it, we have the Spirit of God and our own individual experience mm-hmm. of God. Mm-hmm. And I think that more and more people are realizing that their own personal experience of God, regardless of where they happen to get that or how that happens to come to them, is a valid kind of experience. And I think that that's where a lot of people are saying mm-hmm. that they simply can't allow themselves to be boxed into these little cages of any particular kind of an orthodoxy, because in some way God has spoken to them. And these are not a bunch of crazy people. These are ordinary, everyday people that have been affected in one way or another by a very, very personal, individual kind of experience of God.
Right.
I read somewhere that something like, I think it's 78% of people have some sort of a religious experience or mystical experience. And you talk to people about their individual experiences, and they are so varied. It's just absolutely amazing. But I think that's really tremendous to think that many people have some kind of a unique sense of God's Spirit.
Mm-hmm. So what comes up for me then is I heard some of it being the sincerity that Jill was talking about, and what Lawrence has been talking about seems to be just simply developing an appreciation for another person's model by at least understanding us to be. Does there need to be some understanding that we're worshiping the same God in this model? Is that part of the theocentrism?
I think that's just almost a given, that a theocentric model is...
That's the given I wanted you to say.
Right. It's the end point of the process.
The given I really wasn't getting. The unifying factor that perhaps not everyone understands. you know, simply being that there is a diversity, and I've heard it said somewhere that there must be a unity in diversity, not necessarily a uniformity, but definitely a unity in diversity. And so I'm looking for what are those unifying factors? And I'm hearing sincerity. I'm hearing an appreciation that perhaps it's the same God that we're all worshiping, just with different names, with different constellation of concepts around it. Now,
can I stick in something there? That the one thing that fascinates me that he doesn't address is what the word name means to religions, and why religions are all hung up on the name of God. And one of the Krishna's favorite discussions on this is that everyone could be looking at the same mountain in Turkestan, and on one side they call it Mount Van or something, and on the other side they call it Mount Ararat, and on the other side they call it something else, but it's the same mountain. Mm. The culture identifies with it by what it means to that culture, and they name their gods usually according to their highest concept of what a god means. The English word God, from the Old English word got, G-O-T-T, is one of the most bizarre words. It doesn't sound too great to me. I mean, it doesn't sound like the most wonderful, highest concept of God that I think. Mm-hmm. I haven't come up with a better word yet, but in many other cultures except for English, the word for God actually has a very wonderful and outstanding meaning that we don't have, and we have a generic word for God. And I think in Christianity there's a special place for the name of Jesus, because of in the New Testament the healing powers that were used, and also some of the statements Jesus made to pray in his name if you don't know what to pray for, and those kind of things. And people healed in his name, and those types of things. So for a lot of people, the word has become kind of a fetish for what the person actually is. And we don't separate it very well. Over 2,000 years, there's a magic associated with, in Christianity, with the name Jesus, that even if you don't know what you're doing, and you can just say his name, and it's like invoking a incantation.
Mm-hmm. Well, if I put on my Christian clothes for a moment here, I can see myself, just listening to what you're saying, as having an internal conflict developing, if I'm listening to you honestly and if I'm listening to the discussion that's going on.
And there's
here
a loyalty to the name. That's where that conflict comes from.
Well, exactly. And so I come up with the question is, you know, why should I, as a Christian, and for that matter, if I expand it, let's stick it with Christianity for a minute just to keep it simple, but why, if I, as a Christian, believe in, you know, Jesus is the highest representation of God that I could have ever seen, and looking at his name, why should I take on an attitude of wanting to be a religious pluralist, getting to know about all other religions, versus trying to convert people to my religion, which I believe is the best? This seems to me it has to arise as a conflict. Does anyone have an answer to that?
If Jesus was here, Christians need to ask themselves a question. Would Jesus say, focus your worship and attention on me? Would he say, I am the be-all, do-all, end-all? Or would he be talking about God, the Father? Would he be directing the attention of his followers past and through? Through is an important word. Past and through to the end of the process. All I'm suggesting is that a Christian look at the total process of his evolution to better relationship with God and uniting with God. Mm-hmm. That he allows himself to pass through his steps, but there's an honoring that other steps and other individuals may have also said, God behind me. You know, pointing to God, and that they look at this as this, what's behind Jesus. Mm-hmm. You know, that's a very, I mean, does it all stop with Jesus, or was Jesus a being of great import and power who pointed to the totality of all of it, saying, me and much, much more?
Bill, did you have a point?
Yes, I was going to say that some Christians would answer and say, well, Jesus himself said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And so, depending on where one is with Scripture and how literally one interprets that, and we as Baptists especially have tried to be very biblical, very New Testament specifically in our interpretation of Scripture, then that that raises some real important questions, because if Jesus, you know, and we tend to believe, you know, most of us would believe that that these were the words of Jesus, and so, you know, if Jesus really did, and I think it's an open question in some ways, but at least in the Scripture it says that Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and so that gives some sort of conflict. And so, and then once a Christian starts questioning Scripture, then it becomes kind of a downhill slide on, you know, where do you stop on what parts of Scripture you believe and what parts you don't believe. And then you get to the whole business that if Jesus, you know, if basically you think Jesus was pointing to God rather than to himself, then that may throw into question some things about the divinity of Jesus, and then that in itself then also, you know, leads away, at least it seems to me these things kind of follow, like dominoes falling down. Then where does that leave us with the resurrection? And so then it becomes not only the question of the salvation of people outside the faith, but what do we do about our own salvation? You know, is there life after death for us through Jesus, God's only Son? And so it becomes a real can of worms for Christians who have put all of their stock in the Christian kind of commitment.
May I suggest a model that may not create a conflict with what you said without having a Christian having to throw away and be in turmoil? You said the way, the life.
The way, the truth, and the life.
The way, the truth, and the life. You're more familiar with Christianity than I am. Did Jesus say the only total and final way, truth, and life?
See, again, that's open to speculation or interpretation.
That would be something that I would think a Christian would want to think about, in the sense that they call Jesus the Son of God. The Son of God. So if they're calling him the Son of God, then is Jesus the final, total, and only way, passage through, truth, and light?
Many Christians, that would be the case.
Yeah. Yes. But is that true for God?
That's a question that seems that is up for discussion and is very challenging to probably the average Christian. And so part of what this brings up to me is a conflict that develops between what some people would call belief and faith. Or maybe to give a quick illustration, a friend of mine and I were talking the other day, and he was talking about trying to resolve problems with his son. And in having tried to resolve problems with his son, he realized he knew his son had done something wrong. He knew he had to solve that problem somehow, but he didn't have enough proof to know, you know, exactly how to go about solving that problem. And yet at one point he remembered something that someone had told him and said, don't look at it as a question of right and wrong and something to be proved, but look at it as something that is simply a personal problem to be solved. And that struck me, that all of a sudden here we have things being taken from a completely different level of someone needing to be right to go forward or someone needing to be wrong to be punished, versus going forward and saying, okay, we have this problem and we need to solve it. It seems to me that interfaith dialogue has some of these elements to it. That isn't there a certain amount of, you know, my theology has to be right versus let's solve the problem of getting along and making all of our faiths work together, and that taking primacy for people. That struck me as being an interesting way to view it. Or just putting it simply, it seems to be simply between needing to be logically right versus do I love you or do I not love you?
How about being more right, allowing people to be right, and through exploration and interfaith dialogue, developing more right understandings of God and more right relationships with God and more sincere awareness of other people's right applications with God. Putting it into this either-or terms, I don't think is at least my understanding of interfaith dialogue. It's more, how can we have more of God? How can we have more of our faith? How can we have more belief? Because the common result in a tolerant, well-done interfaith dialogue is you feel stronger about many of your convictions. You've added new things about God you weren't aware of, and you've seen examples of God living, which puts more of God in your life than you had before the dialogue.
Mm-hmm.
So this whole yes or no, you know, right or wrong,
sure.
I think it's the wrong platform. We should be thinking about how do we get more.
But that happens to be the mindset of where many people are. In other words, you know, the questions that are asked, you know, the answers that we get depend on the kind of questions that we're asking. And I think each of us, regardless of what area we're at, you know, have a particular kind of mindset and particular kinds of questions that we ask. But I agree with you that those are the kinds of questions that really ought to be up for grabs more than some of the other questions.
But good interfaith dialogue so honors your truth and your pillars and your faith and your beliefs that in an attitude of not trying to change it, we share and explore, we exchange. And without any effort to proselytize or to convert you, there's this just multiple viewpoint. This is the experience of solving mm-hmm. your own problem.
Sure.
Each person out there is in a faith evolution, and through their life they go through many experiences, and in these experiences they learn and pick up things. Mm-hmm. Why should it be any different in your growing faith?
Joe, I want to ask you, what for you is the crux of the matter? For me, I... Or maybe not to put you so much on the spot, you know, is it more important, how do we get one person from one faith to care more about other people than about what they themselves or what others believe? How do we, what I hear part of this being is that if I care more about what I believe than I care about you,
well, you know, I think sometimes what I was mentioning earlier about what seems to me to be a trap with some religions is if I care about you and I believe the only way for you to achieve salvation is to believe what I believe, then the only way for me to express my caring for you is to browbeat you into believing what I believe, or I'm saving you from hell. That's a place that I think a lot of people really genuinely are, and it's a true expression of caring for them to force on you their belief system. And it's uncomfortable for me, and I'm happy that I'm in a position where I believe that God accepts sincere approaches to Him in lots of different ways, so people don't have to believe what I believe in order to have a relationship with God.
Mm-hmm.
That's much more comfortable for me. And this book, I think, is very well written. What I liked about reading this book was, I think the purpose was as much informative as persuasive, and he's done very good research and is quoting eminent theologians.
Mm-hmm.
So if people read a lot of what has a lot of the thinking, many of the people that he's quoting are wrestling with the problem of how can we retain our belief system and yet broaden our approach to other people's so that we don't shut them out.
Mm-hmm.
And that question isn't always easy to answer, as Bill is pointing out, and yet there are some really interesting, very well-written theological answers in this book.
Mm-hmm.
So I would give this book to people as a way to at least start to broaden their thinking.
I see.
And I'd say people do really instinctively care more about each other than they care about their own beliefs or someone else's. And a good example is yesterday there was a head-on collision with a car and a Mack truck. It was the car's fault, evidently. The truck driver got out after the wreck and saved the five people out of the car, even though two died later. And the trucker himself died. Mm. But he didn't stop and ask these guys or look for their ID card to see what they believed. You know, the instinct of all humanity is to immediately risk your own life and save someone else's, which is the highest ethic, according to Jesus and most of us. Mm-hmm. What happens is we're programmed. And another thing the book doesn't touch on very heavily is the atonement doctrine. We're programmed to believe in salvation to the point of that's so important that for some people to doubt their belief system would mean to risk their salvation. For the average person that hasn't even read the Bible but is a Christian, has never made it all the way through, who couldn't really dialogue with someone about it, their only hope for this type of growth is actually working and living with people of other beliefs. They're not going to be reading books to find out about this. You know, but they may share theocentric beliefs without even knowing it, just because they see God in someone else's life, but they may not even know what the other person calls God. So I think that we're people in our interest area are pretty intellectual about this, but I think a lot of people experience this without ever knowing that they experience it.
The theocentric model puts more attention on our aspirations and our worship as the unity point of what we worship, rather than the most attention on the diversity of how we've come to this appreciation and recognition of God, mm-hmm. or deity. Mm-hmm. And that's probably a big kind of clear difference between a theocentric model and some of the models of other faiths, which are more Christocentric or Buddhist-centric, etc. And I think when we're all looking up at a single point, there's a coming together at that point, mm-hmm. you know, like the hub and the spokes of a wheel, as opposed to when we're all just sort of looking at each other, you know, where's the energy? Mm-hmm. And I think that if we're going to uplift all of our faiths, we look to our ideal, which is God, the nature of God and the way God focus, you know, is, mm-hmm. and that will bring us together, not so much our differences, but God itself and our worship of God. Nothing will bring us closer than that simplicity without having to change your belief to my belief and fight with your belief. We can just worship God and let the love be shared and recognized. I think it's going to solve a lot of problems in a simple way. Mm-hmm. I hate to put it simply.
You know, I was thinking also it might be, you know, you asked the question of how do we get to this point of accepting a pluralistic kind of worldview. And it seems to me that maybe, without being too overly optimistic, to some extent that's already happening just from the day-to-day living experiences that people have. Since we live in such a pluralistic world, it's becoming more that way. And so I've, like my experiences on this show, none of you have really tried to convert me to your beliefs, but
we're going to do that in a few minutes.
We'll do that later, okay.
During the commercial.
Well, I guess I'll change my mind about you then. Mm-hmm. But by just associating with various people, I think that we do get a better understanding. And somehow or other, not only in religion, but in all sorts of areas, lifestyle, sexuality, race, and so forth, we are so pluralistic that somehow or other the whole, I think even from a secular level, the ethic has to evolve within our society around the whole world, that we are somehow or other going to find ways to really get along with one another with some kind of a healthy respect for each other. And then I think there's going to be a lot of cross-fertilization of ideas.
I'd like each one of you to, while I'm giving our listeners and audience the address that they can write to or talk to for Spiritual Spectrum, would you quickly think about what is it that individuals like ourselves or like anyone that is
part of the interfaith dialogue believes in religious pluralism, what simple steps can each one of us take that can, say, further an interfaith dialogue? And with that, let me just quickly let our viewers know that if they want to send their comments or questions or just get in touch with us here at Spiritual Spectrum, they can write to Spiritual Spectrum at 2351 Ogden Street, Denver, Colorado, 80205. And I'm sorry, I don't have the ZIP+4 code. And if they want to call, they can call area code 303-861-1186. So what do you think? What can we do in these last few minutes that we have? What ideas might you have, anyone, that you personally or anyone can do to further interfaith dialogue?
Well, I'd say, first of all, two monologues don't make a dialogue. So if a Jehovah Witness knocks on your door on Saturday morning and you're willing to talk to them, the first thing I always do is say, well, are you willing to listen to me equally? And if they are, we have a wonderful dialogue. And if they're not, then we don't spend too much time together. So for me, both parties have to be willing participants. And I would say most of the witnesses coming to my house are more than willing to dialogue. They're wonderful people, and they believe heartily enough to go out and spread what they believe.
Hmm. Terrific.
I think that what we need to do is to be open to any invitations that we get to join with other people in family gatherings or religious observances or whatever else. And I'm open for invitations. Anyone wants to invite me? and also, you know, I think we should be willing to share our own homes with others and, you know, take the risk and invite people for various things.
Mm-hmm. It's also a risk that I'm taking more to just talk about God in contexts where God isn't usually talked about. And I don't even know what faith people come from in many contexts. But if I bring up God, I soon find out. And then, without it being an intention to do interfaith dialogue, we share.
Adding to what Jill was saying, by exploring God in the individual, how he's reflected in the individual and how God is reflected in their faith and their beliefs, since interfaith is about God, when you see God in the other faith, whether it's in the individual or in the religious views, then you're accomplishing interfaith dialogue and you're getting more of God. Your relationship and understanding is being enhanced. And with the good listening that you mentioned and all the other aspects, this is what it's all about. That's why we do it.
I think we're there by the very fact of who put this book out. You know, if I can say this right, the American Society of Missiology and Orbis Books, this is put out by Christians who probably find this book very disturbing but are willing to stand on their faith and publish something that might disturb some of their community.
Mm-hmm. Just to clarify for our audience, our viewers might want to know that missiology, isn't that essentially the study of missionary kind of activity and how best to bring their religion to other people? So
I believe so.
So if that's the case, then here we're talking about a whole series that's really talking about how do you best bring people to my religion, and having a book about religious pluralism is certainly at least part of that spectrum, but maybe part of a whole big thing that even those that are interested in this topic of missiology are not completely aware of. There is an opening of the can of worms that anybody can sense with this, and yet it seems to be a good can of worms to be opening.
My guess is that missionaries do learn about the faiths of the people they're living among, and by loving the people, they learn about their love for God, and there is some blending, my guess.
I believe that's true. I had the opportunity to visit some of our missionaries in Haiti about 10 years ago, and I was really surprised because my prejudice told me that these were a very stuffy group of people. And I think they become stuffy when they get to this country so they can get get the support to go back to where they're going. But at any rate, I found them very, very open and much different than I had previously thought. And I think they do learn from the people that they work with.
Yeah, it strikes me that you couldn't help but learn from them if you are going to be successful with them at all, that there has to be a natural openness to who those people are and what their culture is. And so it's through that whole service mode that that would happen. And it also struck me earlier in the discussion when somebody mentioned that the term that Jesus used for talking to God was Abba. And one religionist I know who remarked on that said that that's not only a term for father, but it's actually more closer to being a term akin to daddy. And perhaps if all religionists work on their own personal relationship with God, however they find that, in the context of their faith, and just one-on-one with their God, however they conceive Him to be, it seems to me that that and service to others is one way to make faith much more important than whatever particular belief system one has. Are there any other ideas that people have? I mean, how will we... We've only got 30 seconds left.
Quickly. First of all, run down to the tattered cover and buy this book. Order it if it's not in.
Okay.
You can order it from the publisher also.
It is a good, really good book, and I'd recommend it to anyone. It's not a... I want to stay away from the concept of can of worms. It presents challenges, but the exploration, adventure, growth, and enhancement by looking at possibilities of developing a better relationship with God and appreciating God and others is well worth it.
And with that, I'll just let us know, thank you for tuning into Spiritual Spectrum. No other name, Orbis Books, available at fine bookstores everywhere.